All right, praise God, you caught me adjusting there a little bit. Had to get things right with the back. Give God all glory for once again a beautiful day. I never get tired of saying that, and I probably will never quit saying that until that incredibly beautiful day when the Lord says, come on up here with me. Some would say that that's not a great day or not whatever, but you know, and I understand that people left behind will grieve. I get that. But for me, and hopefully for you, it will be a glorious time. You know, that day when you get to go home to eternity, oh my goodness, how much greater day can it be? But again, give God all the glory. Like I said, I hope my volume's up. I see some of you coming on. I hope y'all can hear me. I don't know if that helped or hurt or fixed or whatever. But anyway, to God be the glory. For every day. I know we got some days in front of us as winter comes on that some of us may not like too well. And then, frankly, you know, as I get older, I probably don't like them quite as well as I used to. But at the same time, I do love snow. I love the winter. That's why I haven't moved. Of course, God hadn't told me to either, but that's why I haven't moved to a year-round warm climate. You know, like I said, one, God hasn't told me to, and two, I like the changing of the seasons. So every day that the Lord makes, I will be glad and rejoice in it. And that's the way we should look at these days that we have in front of us as the weather begins to turn colder and, in some people's opinion, going to get nastier. But I said it's all good. That said, welcome to Rock Through the Scriptures. I think it was episode 65. Wow. That's awesome. Pretty sure that's what I put on the title anyway. Proverbs chapter 2. I had no clue what God is going to do this evening. One of the things I've learned is to trust Him, as we all should, and especially those of us that are ministering God's Word. You know, I've had to change on an instant's notice, because of what He told me at the last moment. You know, it should not surprise us. I mean, God wants obedience. And so I've learned, and I don't even get scared or upset or anything like that. When at the last minute He changed. Now, Rock to the Scriptures is a bit different in that we know where we're going to be in the Bible. But what I'm talking about is, and I've had this happen where I get up on Sunday morning, and you know, maybe God had given me a word on a Thursday or a Friday or whatever. And me, assuming it was for that Sunday, and then Sunday rolls around, I said, it's like God's not, nah, yeah, I gave you that. That was for me, but it's not for now. And, I mean, I've had that. I'm honest to God, I've had that walking up to the pulpit. But it has instilled a trust in me. and it has helped me to learn God's voice. So we can't put our plans in concrete sometimes with God. And another thing, you know, he's not going to show you, is that's short term, what I just spoke about. But long term, he's not going to show you 5 years down the road most of the time. And the reason for that is he don't want to scare you. And I've said this many times, if the day I gave my life to Christ, it'll be 24 years, February 28th of next year, okay, if on that day he would have shown me 5 years down the road or whatever, I'd still be running. I didn't know he was going to call me to preach. I didn't know he was going to have me walk up to people in public places and give them a word from the Lord, so to speak. But if he'd have shown me that, I said, forget this. I'm real good at sinning. I'm just going to stay right here. So, but we need to be willing, number one, to change with as God shows us, so to grow is a better way of putting it, as God shows us. If he'd have told me 24 years ago, you're going to be over churches in Kenya, I'd have laughed. That would have been the biggest chuckle of my life 24 years ago. But today it's true. But he didn't allow it to happen until we were ready. So have no fear of the future. When you get there, you'll be ready. All right, praise God. That has nothing to do with Proverbs. All right, let's pray and get on into Proverbs chapter 2. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for this word. We thank you, Father, that you will speak to us tonight through your scriptures, Father, through what you had, in this case, Solomon, penned for us to be able to read and study and understand, that we know that you are speaking to us through this proverb that we are about to read, Father God. You are advising us and directing us in your word, Father God, that you allowed Solomon to write down thousands of years ago. Even before Jesus, Solomon wrote these words in his great wisdom. And so let us now glean from those words, learn from them, take something away that we can use in our lives, Father God. May we read it with understanding. And may you get all the glory and the honor and the praise in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. All right. God bless you all. We love you. I see many of you watching. Praise God. I thank God that you have tuned in to watch us. I believe great news is very shortly down the road. Just leave it at that, and we'll get into Proverbs chapter 2. Again, Solomon says, my son, if you receive my words and treasure my commands within you, you know, in other words, if you're listening in what I'm speaking to you is something that's going to be important to me, and treasure my commandments within you. In other words, if what I'm saying is going to be important to you, so that you incline your ear to wisdom. Now we need to understand something here. Solomon wrote this, and he is considered not only the wisest, but also the richest man that ever lived. People are all fired up about this new, what is it, Powerball? I don't even know what it's up to now. And all that. And it's like, it's a drop in the bucket to the riches of Solomon. Just as some of us or wisdom is dropping the bucket to the wisdom of Solomon. So when he's writing this, we truly should treasure what he's writing, okay? So that you decline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding. In other words, meditate on this word that you can read it with understanding. Pray about that before you even read the word. I mean, not just when we're having wrought through the scriptures, but you should be reading God's word daily and pray about that you would read it with understanding. Verse 3, yes, if you cry out for discernment and lift up your voice for understanding, Lord, help me to understand. God, give me discernment of your word. Let me read your word with discernment and understanding. If you seek her as silver, talking about wisdom, because in verse 2 we see you incline your ear to wisdom, okay, and search for her as for hidden treasures, and you've all, you know, everybody's done some type of treasure hunting at some time or another, in some form or another. Have you ever bought a lottery ticket? Okay. Then you will understand the fear of the Lord. Now again, this is talking about reverential fear of the Lord. It's talking about a respect for the Lord. And find the knowledge of God. So if you take those first four verses and put them all together, if you follow all of that, then you will understand the reverential fear of the Lord, how we should be holding the Lord God Almighty. Okay? That's what it's saying. If you grasp these first four verses in chapter 2, Proverbs chapter 2, then you will understand how we're supposed to look at the Lord. You will get an understanding of who God is. You will draw closer to him, and he will draw closer to you, as he promises in other scripture. And it says, and find the knowledge of the Lord. That's exactly what I was just describing. Mm-hmm. And we move on to verse 6. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. This is nothing you can buy. The Lord gives wisdom. Just as he gave his only begotten son, he gives wisdom. He gives it. Okay. God gave his only begotten son. You have to receive that. God gives wisdom. When you apply those first four verses. And from his mouth, and in a sense, what we're reading is from his mouth. Because everything in the Bible was given by divine inspiration from God to the people that had the pen in their hand. Verse 7, he stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a shield to those that walk uprightly. Now, he stores up sound wisdom for the upright. Again, going back to keeping his commandments in those first four verses that we talked about, and we will probably continue to talk about. Then he stores up wisdom for the upright. In other words, he will impart that wisdom into you. He's very capable and very of imparting wisdom, if we're willing to listen. He's also very capable of blinding us to the truth. How many times in the Bible did the Lord blind people, it's not that they, and I don't mean physical blinding, you know, all you can see is black, okay, your eyelids. No, I'm talking about understanding blindness or discernment blindness. I mean, look, people, when Jesus came, rose from the dead, those that had been following him right outside his tomb didn't know who he was because he did not allow them to know. So he is capable of, if you don't follow these things, not allowing you wisdom, divine wisdom, okay? I'm just putting that out there, okay? He is a shield to those that walk uprightly. You know, in this time of year, I'm reminded, and there was I just ran across the video on YouTube as I was worshiping this evening when I was looking for specific worship song. You know, you always get a whole list of things, especially if you're doing it on a smart TV. And one of them was a man that's well known literally around the world that used to be a warlock. And he talks about Christians celebrating Halloween. Okay. Now, I don't care if you agree with that or if you don't agree with it. If you celebrate Halloween or you don't celebrate Halloween, you have to make your choices. I can bring you the truth, but it's up to you to accept or reject. But this man talks about it and how demonic it is, but he also talks about how in his warlock days, he goes into great detail about how him and his associates, whatever you want, friends, whatever term you want to use, would go and try to pronounce or whatever the word is that they use to curses, etc., on people. And they said they were very careful. They learned to be very careful if they knew a home was occupied by a true Christian, because they learned to just like move on, because when the Spirit of God is in there, it would boomerang back on them. And I'm not sure why I went down that path, but I'll just stay here for a moment. He is a shield. That's why I went to those who walk uprightly. He will protect you. And that was an example. That's why I went down that path. I was giving you an example because of this time of year. I find it fitting that we go from a time that is very satanic in nature this time of year, and we move on into the time of year when people are most open to hear about Christ. These next couple of months, as we enter November today, you know, these next couple of months are when people are the most receptive to hearing about Christ, because we celebrate his birth on December 25th. That was not necessarily when he was born, but in some ways I think it's no accident that we celebrate truth after this was just, and trust me, I did not participate in that celebration. But anyway, he is a shield. So we know that no weapon formed against us shall prosper, as in Isaiah 54:17. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. He is a shield to those who walk upright. When we walk uprightly, he guards the paths of justice and preserves the way of the saints. And I'm telling you, that is a fact. I have experienced it. He guards the way, the paths of justice, and preserves the way of the saints. It's true. Many, many times he has guarded my way. He's also imparted wisdom into me to drink a lot of water. That's good for you. And when you've experienced that and then you read these scriptures, you're like, wow. When I first read this scripture, I had no idea what it meant. But I promise you, when I read the scripture today, I know exactly what it is, because he has guarded my path and he has preserved my way. He stopped me from making many mistakes. And even when I have made mistakes, he's been right there to help me in recovering from things that I, because again, none of us are perfect. Let's move on. We got a lot of verses to cover yet. Verse 9, then you will understand righteousness and justice, equity and every good path. When wisdom enters your heart, when wisdom enters your heart, and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you. Understanding will keep you, to deliver you from the way of the evil. Did I not just talk about that in this former warlock? Now, this guy that I'm talking about is a former warlock, travels the world preaching Jesus Christ today. And he's very open because he knows. Now, they would, and he'll even tell you, the people that he has used to associate with would like for him and would try to shut him up. But he stands on these scriptures that we just read. Verse 8, he guards his path and he preserves his way. Okay. Let me start at verse 9 again. Then you will understand righteousness and justice, equity and every good path. When wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, when you seek knowledge and you enjoy receiving and understanding, discretion will preserve you. Discretion will preserve you. What does that say? It's saying that God's wisdom will have that still small voice speak to you and say, don't go there. Don't do that. Beware of this. Understanding will keep you, to deliver you from the way of evil, from the man who speaks perverse things. Exactly what I was just talking about. From those who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. In other words, he will protect you from that. People will leave the way of uprightness. Understand that. I know there's religions out there, denominations out there, don't believe that, but anyway. Who rejoice in doing evil and delight in the perversity of the wicked. Now, this is what he's saying. We're continuing here. He's protecting you from that. Discretion will preserve you. Understanding will keep you, to deliver you from the way of the evil. And it continues on to get a little more specific about evil, okay? Whose ways are crooked and who are devious in their paths. To deliver you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words. Now, most of you men listening, you've been there. You've had this opportunity, okay? But the Lord, discernment will tell you, you don't want to go there. Because even this warlock that I was talking about earlier, they exercised a little bit of a discernment through having learned you don't mess with the true Christian. You don't mess with someone who is filled with the Spirit of God and keeping his commandments and is upright and standing with God. You don't mess with that dude because it's going to come back at you. But God takes it a step further, okay, in protecting you. And not only will he deliver you from the immoral woman, he will keep you from all that stuff we read in these previous verses. I mean, I know that. There is no doubt in my mind, in my 24, going on 24 years as a Christian, that people have tried to attack me. Not physically, but they've tried to pronounce things on me. They've tried to do their little rituals to place curses. For all I know, they might have tried voodoo dolls. I don't know. Okay, but I can tell you, I know for an absolute fact that attacks have been attempted. And if they had their way, I would have shut up and possibly even be dead a long time ago. But here I am, and here I will remain until God is done with me. No weapon. Isaiah 54:17. I mentioned it earlier. I'm going to mention it again. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. None. In this world where we have tribulation, some of that tribulation comes from what may be attempted with what we've read about here, but it won't prosper. And I will stand against it. God stands against it for me. It's like a shield. And when people try, just look at it like this. There's a shield. And someone points a gun at you and shoots, and the bullet goes back at them. It bounces off. It's the same thing. When these attacks try to come at us, it doesn't work. It can't. If it were to work, then God's word wouldn't be true. If you're standing in upright, if you have taken to heart those first four scriptures and understand what God is saying further in these scriptures of what he will protect you from when you're in upright standing with him, then this most assuredly is for you. Let me get back to where I was here, if that's possible. Okay. To deliver you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words, who forsakes the companion of her youth and forgets the covenant of her God. I'm telling you, there are people out there. Okay. That will do that. There are women out there that will do that. Now, I've seen the opposite. I know, and I absolutely won't mention any names, but I know people that were these type of women that are now women of God preaching the gospel because they got a grasp of what we have been reading tonight. But anyway, moving on, for her house leads down to death. In her paths to the dead. It doesn't get a whole lot clearer than that, okay? None who go to her, nor do they regain the paths of life. So you may walk in the way of goodness and keep the paths of righteousness, for the upright will dwell in the land, and the blameless will remain in it. And this is the last verse, okay? And it's very, very important that you understand this. But the wicked will be cut off from the earth, and the unfaithful will be uprooted from it. Now, as I read that, I'm reminded that the Bible talks about in the end times, when it's all said and done, there will be a new heaven and a new earth. You are part of this earth right now. Either Jesus is going to come back and you're going to be left behind, or you're going to go with him, or one day you will take your last breath and you will go to one of two destinations. And when the day comes that new heaven and new earth, you will have no part of it. And the unfaithful will be uprooted from it. You will be cut off from the earth. You will be cut off from the new heaven and the new earth, for sure. Okay? That is a scary, scary thought. Now, I'll be honest with you. I was there one day. I fit that description one day. If I had have died when I was 30 years old, or frankly, even 40, even 45 years old, I would have been cut off from the earth. I would have been facing eternity in the lake of fire. That's just who I was. I was not a bad person. Being a good or a bad person really doesn't have any being a bad person, obviously they're not saved. But being a good person does not necessarily get you into heaven. Sadly, I know a number of good people that won't make it. I was one of those. At least I like to think I was. I mean, people used to tell me they felt I was a good person. I tried to help people. I used to give people money when they needed it. You know, buy the homeless meals. You understand what I'm saying, okay? But had I died in that, had I died not knowing what we just read, and it was offered to me multiple times, and I would laugh. Hey, yeah, whatever. You know, I'm just going to go ahead and go to hell, and I'll just be with my friends. We'll all be down there cussing and drinking beer, and that's not true. You will be in eternal torture. Yes, the Bible describes a heaven and a hell as real, and we get glimpses of both, and I'm telling you, hell is no picnic. It's not going to be the party that you think it is. It's going to be eternal. And when I say eternal, you know, try to wrap your mind around what eternity is. It's like, dude, that's forever. I mean, it's forever. I have a hard time grasping a hold of that. Because virtually everything we see comes to an end. You know, we have two very good vehicles at this moment. Someday, you know, I'm 70, now soon be 74 years old. I've had a lot of vehicles. And some of them have came to an abrupt end. So we think of things like that. We got a new couch and recliner. One day, they will wear out. So they're not eternal. But burning in hell or celebrating in heaven, whichever one you end up, that's forever. There won't be any end to eternal torture, and there will not be any end to eternally worshiping Christ. No, that's like I said, that can be hard to get a hold of. But what we need in all reality, we don't necessarily have to have an understanding of that. Okay? I don't want to burn the lake of fire for 5 minutes, much less eternity. So I want to grab a hold of what we read in Proverbs chapter 2 this evening and get it in my heart and let me understand, okay? That should be our goal. I don't want to spend the rest of my life studying what eternity is. I want to spend the rest of my life telling people about Proverbs chapter 2, in a sense, about God and God's Word. And so, when my eternity comes, it will be a glorious one. And Solomon's wisdom that came straight from God Almighty is available to us. So, I mean, if somebody offers me a piece of cake, I'm going to jump on it. Just saying. All right, praise God. I hope that, you know, let me go here first. If that is you, if you know you're not right with the Lord tonight and you want to get right with him, it's very, very simple. You know, I preached a sermon a couple of Sundays ago. You know, the gospel of Jesus Christ is very, very simple. Okay, confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. And then even that, you know, keeping a relationship with God is very simple. Jesus boiled it down. Love your neighbor as yourself and love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, whatever, okay? And I mean, you do that, you keep all the other commandments. You keep everything, every other commandment in the Bible. There's a piece of wisdom for you. The Gaithers even made a song that relates to those scriptures, loving God, loving each other. And we talked about song, we talked about music Sunday, okay, and what, you know, things being biblical. I don't like music. I don't care if it is Christian music. If it's not biblically based, I don't want to hear it. I don't want false doctrine entering. But loving God and loving each other, that's just boiling down what Jesus said. All right. Anyway, if you you want that relationship, it's very simple. I'm going to lead you in a prayer that you repeat after me, and we'll go from there. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you a sinner. I ask that you forgive me, as I now confess with my mouth, because I believe in my heart on the Lord Jesus. Take me and mold me and let me begin a walk with you into my call and my destiny that you have already preordained. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if that was you, praise God. I encourage you to get in some good biblical-based teachings. Again, we're here every Tuesday with Rock Through the Scriptures. Tamara's here every Thursday at 7 o'clock with a word from the Lord. And we are currently online every Sunday. We are, I believe, soon and very soon going to be in person on Sundays in addition to being live. And so, and you know, if you choose not, you know, if I'm not the guy you like to listen to, we know pastors literally all over the world. And so we can get you hooked up. But I encourage you, get them some biblically based teaching and continue to grow. All right, God bless you all. I pray that tonight has blessed you. I pray that we can take the words of Solomon and understand that it is wisdom straight from God Almighty. And may we take it with us into tomorrow and the next day. God bless you all. Tamara will be live Thursday. We love you, and you can't do anything about it.